Reich has shaped an abundant number of legacies and visions in many fields of German and even European archaeology. Within this setting, it's merely possible to select one example, which constitutes a considerable grievance, in particular for the cooperation within the context of international Neolithic research. It concerns the development of German megalithic terminology that originally moved within a joint European terminology before being eluted from linguistic and professional circles during the Third Reich. This deliberate action transpired in full awareness of the consequences. At present, a comparison of German and other European megalith remains complicated. Summarized, the German megalithic typology commonly taught is based on architectural differences between the monuments. For instance, the arrangements of orthostats within the standing stones, as well as the presence or absence of a passage and its position in relation to the overall monument. Counting the pairs of stones facing one another, called Joch in German, meaning yoke, is a specific German criterion, and based on their number and placing, a megalith grave is identified as Urdolmen, Erweiterter Dolmen, Großdolmen, or Ganggrab. Particularly, the structure called Ganggrab in German does not, in its architectural design, in any way correspond to the literal translation for megalithic monuments as passage grave, dolmen a couloir, tumba de corredor, gongrift, or ganggrab found in other European regions. Also, any attempt to translate the German Urdolmen, meaning a form of simple dolmen architecture, encounters difficulties, since no other European language designates a form of megalithic tomb as original or primary by adding an analogy to the German prefix Ur to its name. Thus, the term proves untranslatable, necessitating the continued use of Ur in the present paper to convey its meaning. According to radiocarbon data, the oldest megalithic graves in Europe are located in Brittany and Spain, not in Germany, as the historic handed down term Urdolmen implies. But from which circumstances could it be that German terminology is going these isolated ways? It was a Swedish professor, Oscar Montelius, who, in comparison with French and Scandinavian megalith graves, formulated as early as 1899 a fundamental division of monuments in dolmens, passage graves, and cists, in Swedish as well as in English, French, and German too. This provision was accepted widespread into European languages as terminological foundation till today, primarily in Germany too. A large-scale survey of megalithic tombs in the German Reich did not occur until the time between 1926 and 1928, pioneered by the young and ambitious archaeologist Ernst Sprockhoff in Lower Saxony. His analysis from 1930 exemplified the latest status of German megalithic research in the Weimar Republic before the National Socialist takeover. From 1928 on, the chamber size became Sprockhoff's primary typological feature, measured by the number of yokes. This concept was developed by Sprockhoff himself. In principle, his terminology and conclusions before the Third Reich remained within the boundaries of Montelius and European terminological development, yet with a local alteration of counting yokes. Reviewing Low Saxon megalith graves in the year 1930, Sprockhoff already speculated about the potential language and race of its builders. This notion, and similar ones, based, among others, on the teachings of Sprockhoff's first academic mentor, Gustav Kossinna, resulted in the efforts of multiple archaeologists and institutions during the 1930s to redefine pre- and proto-historic epochs in a manner more suited to current times. The point of focus on this effort was to retrace the genesis of the German people back till the Stone Age. The Neolithic period, during which most of the megalithic tombs had been constructed, was going to be rebranded as Urgermanenzeit, that will mean Original Germanic Age, or Indo-Germanenzeit, Indo-Germanic Age. This fundamental terminology already simulated an elite cultural continuity stretching from the Stone Age until the present, for which German archaeologists intended to gather evidence. From 1935 on, Sprockhoff functioned as second director of the Römisch-Germanische Kommission in Frankfurt, advancing to first director in the wake of Gerhard Berthoud's emigration. He maintained his position as director of the commission during his military service in Norway until the end of the war. During the Third Reich, he evidently strove to prove the emergence of an Ur-Germanentum, original Germanicness, during the Stone and Bronze Age in North German areas. Now, 6 years and a change in political ideology later, and against the backdrop of his moderate analysis of Low Saxon megalithic graves in 1930, Sprockhoff's choice of words assumed a much more gazing tone. He not only contended that, quote, the emergence of the Germanic people dates back around 4,000 years, but he also added, while adopting and redefining Latin Nazi rhetoric, quotation, there already is an explicitly Nordic culture to be found in the Younger Stone Age, approximately about 2000 BC, namely the same culture carried by the builders of the megalithic graves. The prevalence of these graves, and thus the dominion of Nordic Germanic culture of the Stone Age, comprises a much more larger area than the one represented by the exclusively Germanic land of 12,000 AD. In order to differentiate these Neolithic cultures within the North German area, Sprockhoff employed his newly developed terminology and expanded it, valuing political considerations more than the actually present shape of the graves. He effectively subsumed all Neolithic structures under a National Socialist formula. So, the ensuing typology of megalithic graves, developed by him, was founded on an intentional selection of megalithic tomb types that fitted into the politically motivated pattern of a table prehistoric evolution from the Stone Age until the origin of the Germans. Now, Sprockhoff defines a new special Nordic Germanic type of tombs. The oldest forms, ranging from the initial Ur-Dolmen to the extended dolmen, to the beginnings of the great dolmens and the polygonal dolmens, as well as the oldest passage graves, are all located in Schleswig-Holstein, which shows that this land must have played a direct part in the emergence and evolution of Nordic megalithic graves. As pointed out by Sprockhoff himself, his seriation was exclusively based on shape and size, depending on the number of yokes. He did specify his newly minted megalithic grave shapes by supplying a universal pattern plan. This plan yet was outside the corresponding sites, thus ensuring his line of argumentation could not be followed without extensive expert knowledge in the field of North German megalithic monument, which at this time nobody else had. Otherwise, the objects found in the chambers were of no chronological or typological importance whatsoever. A possible simultaneous use of multiple architectural megalithic grave shapes was therefore categorically excluded from the terminological discourse. Sprockhoff concludes, at this point, one might call the megalithic people cut off in the north as Ur-Germanic, that they only became this native people after merging with a single grave people. It is their sons who accept their historic role as Teutons. With this famous and much cited fundamental work called The Nordic Megalithic Culture, Sprockhoff established his ideological terminology within German professional circles and enabled his rise to a megalithic luminary among prehistoric archaeologists. From that point onwards, the Gallengrab in German terminology only referred to a rectangular chamber with a passage in its long side, while in Spain, France, Great Britain, Ireland, Denmark, and Sweden, the words tumba de corridor, dolmen a couloir, passage grave, Gallengrabe, or Gallengrüfter used to, and still do, refer to polygonal, round, or angular chambers with a long passage located on any side. Sprockhoff himself never used internationally developed terms like gallery grave, which would fit better to his Gangrab shape to indicate the German monuments too. Sprockhoff used repeatedly the ideological foundations of Assyriation. This monograph from 1938, whose text like this one is seen, along with his later edited Megalithic Atlas, a standard work and reference of German megalithic research till today. Just, we German megalithicians still do not quote the text anymore, but the book as whole. Even later on, Sprockhoff did not distance himself from these Germanic-centric statements, quite a contrary. During the Second World War, he served as commander in the German coast artillery in Norway, where he even guided excavations and published in cooperation with the SS a guide on Norway's Germanic prehistory. After the war, Sprockhoff gained a reputation as professor of prehistory at the University of Kiel. In the following decades, he conducted a substantiated recording of over 900 North and Middle German megalithic graves. The so-called Sprockhoff numbers and the classification put forth in his Atlas of Megalithic Graves, spanning several volumes from 1966 to 1975, marked German megalithic tombs down to the present day. Describing the grave shapes in his atlas, Sprockhoff kept to his terminology developed between 1936 and 1945, without in any way taking advantage of the West and North European research documentations and sources, which would have been easily accessible now that the war was over. On the contrary, in 1957, 12 years after the end of National Socialism, Sprockhoff still wrote, "The weathered stone graves with their culture remain the first historic miracle of our nation. With it, the great historic line of Germanic ancestors begins, for later there was not a single moment during which the land turned desolate and empty. The blood flow was not interrupted for a single moment." This quote clearly shows no renunciation of those deeply National Socialist blood and soil notions, nor a corresponding linguistic form of its expression. During the country's partition, Sprockhoff's research foundations not only pertained to West German institutes, but also to archaeology in the GDR. In East Germany, it was Ebert Schuld who processed Neolithic research. He systematically excavated and analyzed over 400 megalithic graves in Mecklenburg between 1964 and 1970. In the 1960s, Ernst Sprockhoff repeatedly traveled from Kiel to Schuld's excavation in East Germany, aiming to discuss Schuld's findings with him. Schuld himself describes his choice of terminology for Mecklenburg as follows, quotation, "The expert in German megalithic graves, Ernst Sprockhoff, has quite fixed terms for the different shapes of graves years ago. While this means that a Ur dolmen was a single grave, the extended dolmen housed more deceased, and the large dolmen and Ganggräber enabled the burial of larger and large collectives." Most importantly, Schuld adopted the burden term Urdolmen without criticism for referring to the small closed chambers. Although Schuld realized some weaknesses of Sprockhoff's system, for example the lack of inventory examinations together with the grave shapes, he still desisted from harking back to Montelius or from establishing a nomenclature of his own. Ever since, this German terminology introduced by Sprockhoff and refined in both West and East Germany by younger colleagues like Eckhard Arner or Ebert Schuld, including the classification based on the number of yokes that is still unique throughout Europe, belongs to the unquestioned standards of German prehistoric archaeology and academic teaching and research. In addition, it is currently being studied by all students in the bachelor courses concerning Stone Age monuments. So, even 70 years after the Third Reich ended, it is still essential to question uncritically accepted technical terms accrued from history and to become aware of the resulting problems for European cooperation. Even if it should prove impossible or unreasonable to actually eliminate ideologically burdened terms like Urdolmen from the historically mooted jargon of our present, or bringing back the term Ganggrab to a more suitable peasant grave architecture, then both German and other European students need at least to be equipped with knowledge about the context of these terms in comparison to their respective native languages. This way, students may become aware of the possibilities of ideological abuse within our field that extends back into the Stone Age age, enabling them to prosper in light of this awareness. Thank you for your attention and interest.